Good morning, everybody. We are online, and maybe for some of you, it's probably not morning, it's afternoon, lunchtime, evening. So hello to everybody. It's Martin Nitscher and Olivier Bussard. And first of all, I would say, Olivier, the microphone is yours. Hello to you.
Thank you, Martin, and good morning, good afternoon to everybody. It's a real pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the UPU for that second innovation talk organized by the Direct Marketing Advisory Board. It's a real pleasure because we are now continuing our innovation journey with Martin, and we're going to do today a very exciting part of our journey, which is a deep dive into social media. We saw during our previous discussions that social media are gaining a huge level of importance in direct marketing and in marketing in general. So I'm very excited for to witness this this new innovation talk on social media, to understand better how to use social media, to better grasp the opportunities of social media for direct marketing. And especially today, we're going to have this deep dive into LinkedIn, and we're very excited with it. So Martin, I give the ball back to you and wish you all a very good webinar. I wish you good health, and wish you also a very good holiday seasons for those who will join their families and friends, and be healthy and be safe. Martin, the mic is yours now.
Thanks, Olivier. Thanks to you. And I think the wish to stay healthy and safe is probably one of the wishes which is, well, it's probably as old as human beings are, but on the other side, it got a new importance over the last year. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, direct marketing and especially social selling got a lot of attention, especially LinkedIn in the B2B sector got a lot of attention over the last year. And there's a direct linkage between these two. So I think that was a perfect giving over to me, Olivier, because what we see is that the B2B selling is changing tremendously. Things like fairs or like lunch meetings were not possible over most parts of the world over the last 10 months. And what we saw is that the social selling instead of person-to-person selling got a lot of momentum and was getting more important. So what we thought when we developed the series is to get a little bit of deep dive into this topic, into social selling and B2B sales, especially as for most of you, this is interesting in two ways. It might be interesting, well, probably even three ways. The first one would be, it might be interesting for you as a POS operator. So how do you sell your products, your services to your clients? And this might be a way to get into that one more. The second one is you have clients who are B2B as well, so you might be able to help them to get more attraction and to connect this with more direct marketing. And the third one, and this is a little bit different, I think some of the things I'm telling today might be interesting for you on a personal level, on your personal profile on LinkedIn, because LinkedIn is a big platform, and it's a big venue in a way, and a marketplace, and it's a marketplace where you are on or should be on. And so it might be interesting not only from a postal operator view or a company view, but as well from a personal point of view. I have the great opportunity today to be both host, moderator, and as well presenter. So I'll just take my time because I have no host who is telling me to get faster. But whenever you have a question, this is a dialogue session. It should be something where you can ask questions. So whenever you have a question, please just put it in the chat and I will try to answer that while the presentation or after the presentation. And of course, we will have some time after the presentations for your questions as well. So let's start. What are we doing in the next 45 minutes? First of all, well, 60 is all in, including questions and everything. First of all, I would like to get a little bit into why you should think about LinkedIn from your personal point of view, but of course, especially from your company's point of view. We will have a discuss a little bit about strategy. I brought something with me, which is called the vitamin C strategy. So something which you might help you on LinkedIn and other social platforms. Then I will do something very special with you, and you can already think about that one. I will switch over to a live LinkedIn view, and I will have a look on some of your profiles. So if somebody of you wants to have his or her profile checked, and we'll do a little bit of coaching, no problem. Just tell me in the link, in their chat, and I would be happy to check your profile. Then we will have a little bit look into content on LinkedIn, and especially contacts, so the network itself. And at the end, we will, and that is, I think, something very important, we will have a look into how you can capitalize your LinkedIn network for your company and your postal operator. So we have a very intense session, but let's start with a little bit of top-down view and why LinkedIn is getting more and more important. So what I would like to do is close your eyes. You won't see anything, it's not important. Close your eyes and think, imagine you are on a party, a big party. Lots of people there, big room, very nice surrounding, a lot of people, and you are on this party to meet the guy or the woman you want to have for your life. So very special party. You are looking for somebody. It's very important for you personally. What would you do to find this person on this party? You don't know anybody. You are very new to that group of people. You are invited, but nobody knows you. So what you do? I have three opinions, three ideas what you could do. And now you can open your eyes again. So the first one, it's only suitable for some of you, but you could dance on the piano, especially if you would do this naked, you probably would get a lot of attention from everybody. For me, this wouldn't be the right strategy. Personally, I think nobody of you want to see me dancing naked on the piano, especially if I start to sing. Probably the room would be empty faster than I'm on the piano. So I think it's not the right strategy for me. But if you look from this, from a market view, from a marketing perspective, business perspective, this is in a way classical advertising, getting a lot of attention, disturbing the people, classic advertising, and dancing naked on the piano on the party. You don't see the others are seeing you, the others are seeing what you're doing, and there might be one or two or three or more who like you, who likes you singing on the piano. And then afterwards, if you are really lucky, these two or three might go to you and start a conversation with you. But it's not depending on you, it's depending on them. So if you sing good, have a great figure, this might be a way. But I think we all agree, for most of us, it's not the right way to do advertising, and probably not the right way to do a party. The second idea, the second strategy I could give you is hitting on every woman or man, well, depending on your personal preferences, which is on that party. So you're just trying to get speaking to everyone and just, getting very directly to them, saying something like, well, I'm on the journey to find my life partner. Would you be interested to be my life partner? So you're talking to 10, 15, 20, 50, 80, 100 people, whatsoever. Everybody on this party is not safe from you. You're very direct and just telling them, I'm looking for my life partner. Would you be interested? And probably most of them would be very astonished, and most of them wouldn't be directly interested in getting your life partner. There might be luck. There might be something, somebody in between these 100 people who might be interested. But in the end, this is what we all call cold acquisition. So it's a very cold and harsh way to speak to people and trying to get them interested in you. And who is doing this in a B2B sales environment? We all know it's a hard work. It's not easy. You get a lot of no's before you get one yes. And especially if you do cold calling, it's not very nice. A lot of countries have forbidden it. So probably strategy number two is not the right strategy for your party as well. And then there's a third strategy. And to be honest, that would be the one I would look for. And that is getting in touch with people, having a conversation with them. Of course, you might have a look around. You might have a look who is doing what, who is looking interesting. You're looking maybe what the closest of the people are who might be having the right things of your target group. And then you start to talk with people. You are getting in talk. You are getting to know them, getting in touch with them. And in the end, you might find the right partner. It's the harder way. The way takes a little bit longer than hitting on everybody or just dancing on the piano. But in the end, this way seems for me personally more like good direct marketing, good CRM, or as the new term for this is social selling. Getting social, and of course you are selling something. You are selling yourself on that party, in a way you're doing it in a different way. So if I say this might be the right way for a party, it's probably even especially the right way for business, and especially for B2B business. And the good thing is there is a big party out there. There's a really, really huge party out there. There's a party with 722 million participants. And that party is called LinkedIn. And the interesting thing is, all these 722 million people are on LinkedIn because they are looking for their partners. They are looking for vendors. They are looking for new employees. They are looking for capital. They are looking for business partners. But they are on there in a business-to-business point of view, and they are all interested in finding new partners. So that's a very interesting party for you to be on. And on the other side, there's one special thing on this party, which is even better than a real party. Meaning, on this party, on LinkedIn, everybody has to give his CV, his past things, his interests, to give somebody at the starting of the party. And you can see, you get a big file on everybody, what they are interested in, what they are doing, did before, what they would like to do. So you have a profile of 722 million people on this party. And even before you're starting to talk to somebody, you know quite a lot about them. Imagine this. Imagine you know everything on everybody on the party you are going to if you're looking for a partner. Wouldn't that be great? And this is exactly what you're getting on LinkedIn if you are doing it right. And of course, you have to do that in the right way. So there are other parties out there, to be honest. It's not only LinkedIn. And if you have a look into this, there are, of course, other parties. There are parties like Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and so on, who are more the, let's say, the B2C parties for a different target group, for a different audience. They are great parties, don't get me wrong, but they are very different to this B2B LinkedIn party. Why? Because people, you, me, everybody, is on Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and so on because we are there from a private point of view. We want to show our friends what our lunch looks like. We want to show our great holidays. We want to connect with friends and peoples we know from the past, from school, maybe. We want to connect with our friends there. So it's a private point of view. So first of all, these parties have a private character. And LinkedIn is the only global social network or the only global party for professional content, where people would like to have professional partners and not private personal partners. And that's a big difference. Even if you're looking for B2B, especially if you're looking for B2B or high-end B2C sales, these people are on LinkedIn because that's what they are looking for. So you are in the right environment. If you sell B2C, of course, there are better parties than LinkedIn. If you're selling normal B2C mass market, then Facebook, Instagram, and so on, they are great parties to be on. But if you're looking for B2B sales or high-end B2C sales, then LinkedIn is the only global social network, the only party you should be on. Secondly, beside of all these B2C parties, there are some local B2B parties. I know there is a B2B network in China, for example. There is one in the European, in the German-speaking region, which is called Xing. There are some other local business-to-business networks, but there is only one global network. LinkedIn has no competitor on a global base. Does anybody from you know who LinkedIn is belonging to? What is the mother company? Who's the owner of LinkedIn? Just write it in the sound. Does anybody know? Some people trying to writing. Yes, Microsoft is a question mark behind it. Yeah, you're right. LinkedIn belongs to Microsoft. They bought LinkedIn for some $1 billion in 2016. And they are integrating it more and more into their professional network. So it's very interesting to see how this might be integrated in the future in networks like Microsoft Teams, how it might be integrated in Microsoft 365. It's not yet there. It's already integrated with the CRM system, Microsoft Dynamics. But this party belongs to Microsoft, and Microsoft is really, really investing in that network. And it's the only professional network out there. So coming from that and looking more into, okay, what should we be aware of and what should we be doing is the next thing I have to tell you, there's something else which is really important, which most of you probably haven't even thought of. If you are doing your social networking like Instagram or Facebook and so on, even LinkedIn, you are normally have never got an education about it. You just learn it by doing, and you don't probably have a strategy how often you post your lunch or how often you show your holidays or which people to show which holidays or which side of your holidays. So normally we use our social networking on a pure coincidence or intuition way of doing things. And that's okay. That's absolutely okay if you're on Facebook. It's absolutely okay if you're on Instagram. Just do what you do and have fun with it. But LinkedIn is a professional tool. And for every professional tool, you should have a strategy. So ask yourself, do you have on a personal level, not from a company point of view at the moment, but from your personal point of view, do you have a strategy what you are doing on LinkedIn? Do you have a strategy who you would like to speak to on LinkedIn, who you would like to find on LinkedIn, what you would like to sell on LinkedIn? So do you have a strategy for LinkedIn? Maybe some of you have. But from my experience, most of the people don't have any, well, at least written or any other way strategy for their LinkedIn. They started LinkedIn maybe a month ago, maybe some years ago, maybe even 10 or 15 years ago. They put on their profile, it is not regularly current, made current. I just spoke with Olivier, for example, his photo is about 8 years old, which is, well, he's good looking on that photo. He's good looking in real life, but it's not really current. And most of the people I know, they don't really have a strategy for LinkedIn. And from my point of view, this is a mistake because LinkedIn is not a private social network. LinkedIn is a professional social network. And if you're going to a fair or if you're going to see people in a professional networking situation, you probably have a strategy. If you're going to a fair, you are thinking beforehand, which would be the booths, the vendors I would like to visit. You probably even make some appointments beforehand. You are going over the fair, you are looking which are the ones who are interesting to speak to. So you have a strategy you are working on. So you should have one as well for this big marketplace, which is called LinkedIn. So let's think about how could your strategy look like. So first of all, as all social networks, even every social network as well, LinkedIn is around contacts, the members, and content, what is going on there. So if you look for Facebook, it's about people on Facebook posting content. So it's for every social network the same. Some social networks are more around the content. For example, let's say Twitter is more around the content. The persons, the network is not so interesting. Others as well, like Instagram, is more about content. Others like Facebook is a little bit more about both contacts and content. And there might be others who are more about the context. Thank you, Olivier, for letting me make this example. Sorry for that. So if you see this context and contact, the question is, how do you combine these on LinkedIn? Because on LinkedIn, both contacts and content are the two relevant things. And they are on the, let's say, same level. They are same, they have the same importance, the network and the content, which is combining the people in the network. So how could you combine them in a strategy? And I would recommend you this strategy. It's a lot of C's. That's the reason why it's called Vitamin C strategy. But it starts very simple at number one. So compose your strategy, your orientation on LinkedIn. Think about what you would like to do there. Then, second, you configure your profile according to your strategy. So you make your profile looking not only nice, but going along on what you would like to get there on LinkedIn. Afterwards, you have number three, four, and five, comment, curate, and create. And these three are all around the content on LinkedIn. So you comment, react on content, you're creating new content, and especially you are creating content. We will talk about this a little bit deeper later on. And after that, you start to connect with other people, number six. You communicate with these people, number seven. And in the eight end, you're starting to capitalize on these network you build up. And if you look at this strategy, you will see that is it's a continuously strategy. So it's not unimportant that this is the mathematical mark of endless. So it's continuity, which is important. And you have, of course, to have some controlling of what you're doing there as well. And if you look at these steps, it's not that different from direct marketing, to be honest. In the end, social selling on LinkedIn is a new way, a little bit different way, but in the end, it's nothing else than a good direct marketing. And you can do great direct marketing on LinkedIn. Why? Because you know much more about your target audience, about the individuals in your target audience, than you know in any other way of direct marketing in the past. In the past, in the B2B market, for example, you knew the industry of somebody, you knew maybe the job name, the job position name, but that was it. You might have known that he was interesting in this or that, but the amount of information you had, especially in B2B, was quite low. It was better in B2C. You had a little bit more information about housing and interest in geodemographic data and so on in B2C. But in B2B, there wasn't a lot of information out there. In LinkedIn, you have all this and you can use your direct marketing strategy. And in the end, this is not more than a direct marketing strategy. You can use this on a much deeper level on LinkedIn. So let's have a look in the different parts. So starting with your LinkedIn orientation, number one, you're setting your goals. What do you want to reach on LinkedIn? Do you want to find customers? Do you want to find a new job? Do you want to find capital for your startup? What do you want to get there? Then you define your target contacts. Who are the people you want to have in your network? that might be potential clients, that might be potential employers, it might be somebody who has the capital. So these are the ones who can help you to reach your goals. And you should strategically think about who is it you want to have in your network. Then you think about how you are positioned in this network. So what is your USP? What is what you are delivering for your network? What is your brand in this network, your personal brand or your company brand, or especially both? And in the end, you as well have to think about the keywords you want to be found in LinkedIn. Why? Because LinkedIn is a big search machine. It's a big thing like Google. Everybody is looking on LinkedIn for searching for somebody. And as well, Google has LinkedIn in its registers and in its database and is using LinkedIn. So you have to connect your profile with the keywords you want to be found for. And then LinkedIn is a good way to start for you. I will have some small tips for you as well. So my tip here is, even if you're a marketing professional, and I think most of you are probably marketing professionals, I think at the same time, most of you haven't thought about your LinkedIn orientation, about your LinkedIn strategy. So what I really would recommend to you is to sit down, take a piece of paper or start your word processor, and then write down your goals, your target group, your positioning, and your keywords, and really start to have your strategy. Afterwards, if you have your strategy, if you know who you want to reach, you optimize your profile on LinkedIn. There are a lot of elements in a good LinkedIn profile. And what I will do now is go with you a little bit live into profiles of LinkedIn and have a look at them. And there was somebody, give me a second, I'm copying the link. So you might see that I'm not looking at you now. That is the reason is that I have two monitors here, two displays here. So don't be mad that I'm not looking at you for the next minutes, but yeah, I will, yes. So we have here Gregory Lukowski from Switzerland. And this is his LinkedIn profile. Let's start at the top here. And he has a nice photo of himself. He has a nice background photo here. This is good. He has a lot of connections and it looks good from the first impression. There's something about the profile photo which is not perfect, because the background of the profile photo is quite, well, let's say a little bit disturbing. It's not really quiet, not really calm. So his face could be a little bit bigger and the background could be a little bit calmer. But in the end, it's a good profile as a start. Then he has done something very interesting. If you look at this part here, developing new business models with innovative external partners to shape the Swiss Post of tomorrow. This is called the job, the profile slogan. And from originally, if you start LinkedIn will put here in your position and your company. And this is quite boring. This one is a great slogan because everybody is knowing now what is Gregory about. And this is important as a kind of USP for him. And then we see the about section. The about section here is very interesting because it's the biggest section in the LinkedIn profile with about 2,000 characters, which you can use in your way. So what you have to do is, the 2,000 characters are not shown directly, but there is only shown the first two sentences or the first two lines. And then you have the see more. So what you have to do is you have to have a cliffhanger here in this first sentence, making people clicking on see more. And that is something I think which Gregory could do a little bit better. He is talking about himself here, which is okay. But it's not really the sentence. It's not really a question. It's not really a reason why I should click on see more. So that one could be done a little bit more. And he is just using about, let's say, 200 characters of 2,000, so 10%. He could use much better this about field, this about thing for himself. But it's okay. It could be more about what he is looking for, what he is interested in, what he has is his USP is. So there are some more chances to use here. So we are going down, and then here's something not doing. You could offer here your last activities. I will show this to you in one other profile. Let's have a look here. Featured. So Adrian, he's online as well. He is using this featured section where you can feature some of your content. So everybody on your profile, going on your profile, will see this featured section. And this is very important. It's a very nice place to place some things. So this is something Gregory is not doing, where you could do better. Then we have something here. This is his experience. This is his work experience, which is good. He is showing in which companies he worked before. He has mixed it a little bit up because the MBA wouldn't be a work experience. There's an extra section for education, so I would probably put the MBA below the education. But in the end, he has his working experience here. And what he did good is that he put some sentences in what he did. This is good. He could even do it a little bit better, not only telling what you did there, this job, but what you reached, what you did good, what your successes were. So this might be something where you can even optimize this very good profile. Then we are going down. This is his education. This is good. Again, he puts some things in there, which is good. And then we are going down to see his licenses. So this is good. An Ironman finisher, of course, is great. This is showing that he is doing in sports and has a long duration of things. So this is great. And then we have something here, which is a good idea, which is done not perfect, his volunteering experience. It's good that he has it in here, but he should combine it with the right alumni network so that we don't have this uninteresting blocks here, but the right icon from the HSG alumni network. Then we have some skills and endorsements, which are good with him as well, because he has the right ones here. You can organize them yourself. And he has a lot of people, 49 people, 46 people, 43 people, who are saying he is good about digital strategy, he is good about business networking, he is good about learnability, which is good as well. Then he has some recommendations. 3 is not really that many, but at least he has some. He has given 1, but he has received 3. And that might be a point where Gregory, who has a great profile, to be honest, can optimize his profile a little bit and to add more recommendations. And then he has some accomplishments, especially some honors and some languages, which is good as well. So what we see here is what you just saw is a really, really good profile. There are some smaller things he could change or optimize, but in the end, it's a good profile to show. Wait a second, I will show you one more. We had one more person who would like to do that. That's Gustavo, again, Switzerland. We can't always use Switzerland. So if you look at Gustavo's profile here, there are some things I would see on the first view you see you can do better. For example, you see here this big gray picture. That's a standard image from LinkedIn, and it's not really interesting, to be honest. So he should build his own background picture. Second, his photo is okay, but it's very small. His face is very small. And look here, you see some other people on LinkedIn. And if you see that photo in that size, you couldn't see his face anymore. So he should make his face bigger in this photo. Then we have his name, which is Gustavo D. Well, D is nice, but it's not really his full name. And you want to show yourself, you want to sell yourself. So you should show your name on LinkedIn. So who are you? People want to know your name. Then we have about section again. He put a lot of more information here and he put some USPs in. So he is fluent in some languages and so on. But I think again, it's not very good structured. You should structure it a bit more and giving more help to read that. So we have some activities, we have some experience. So he's from UPU, which is good. He put some text in here, which is good as well. But again, if you look at this year, for example, we have again these uninteresting blocks, block buildings, box pictures. You could do better in connecting these with the right companies. And if you look down to skills, he has some skills here as well, but less people. And he has some recommendations as well. So again, we have a good profile, not a perfect one, but a good profile here from Gustavo. And I will do a short one on the last one because I wanted to show you something here. And Olivier told me that I'm allowed to use this profile. If you look into this one, it's again, there are some things to see. For example, look into the URL. This is the standard URL you're getting from LinkedIn, and you can change it. And nobody wants to have a 9288 something in this URL. So you should change this in your name on LinkedIn so that you have a great LinkedIn URL. Again, we have the background picture, which is not nice. I already talked about his profile picture, which is a bit old. He's looking nice. Well, he could smile. That would be nicer, but it's okay. He's telling everybody what he is, but he is not telling everybody what he could do for them. So this one might be nicer. And if you're looking down to experience, he has put in there what he did in the past. Sometimes he connected it to the UPU, sometimes not. So again, we have here the boxes. And he didn't really tell what he did in there in these things and what his successes were. So he could do better on that one. He has some skills, but not a lot endorsements. So there, he could ask other people to tell them. So for example, me, I could say, well, he has a lot of knowledge about direct marketing, has a lot of knowledge about international relations. So I could endorse his skills. And again, he has only one received recommendation. I think he could do better. I know that he's speaking not only English, but for example, French as well. So he didn't put the languages in here. So again, we have a profile which could be better. So coming back to this, what I'm telling you is really think about your personal LinkedIn profile and what you want to reach, what are your goals, and then optimize your profile along your goals. And as I already told with the Olivier's thing, change your URL so that you have your personal LinkedIn address and put this URL of your LinkedIn in every email you're sending out so that everybody can connect with you on your URL. That's an easy way to do it. So if you have optimized your URL, you should start. I will want to answer one question. One question from Mohamed Eptizam. What's the benefit of profile in marketing? Well, if you have an unoptimized profile, you are not interesting. And when the people are going on your profile, for example, because you want to connect with them, they don't know why they should connect with you. Let's get back to the party example. If you are staying on the edge of a party, you have uninteresting clothes, you don't speak with everybody, and if somebody asks you something, you are looking to the other side and are very shy. This is something like a not good profile on LinkedIn because you don't give the people information about you, which is interesting for them. So you shouldn't tell them there everything, but you should be open about what your successes are, what you have, what your USP is, what you can do and what you maybe cannot do, and especially what your value, your benefit to other people could be. And that's what you should show on your profile on LinkedIn. And afterwards, if you have your right strategy and you are optimized your profile, you are going into content. So you start to react on other people's content. You start to comment on this content. And there are a lot of ways to connect with other people already about reacting and commenting. So for example, there's a good trick, a good tip you can do. You can mention other people in your content. So if you comment something and you think, okay, that might be interesting for Gregory, you could put in an at sign and then start to type his name, and then his name is coming on. And afterwards, you're writing something like, oh, wouldn't this be interesting for you, Gregory, at Gregory? And then Gregory gets an email from LinkedIn, even if you're not connected to him, telling him, okay, Olivier sent me a mention in this comment about this contact, about this content. And then you can start to get into a conversation with Gregory in that case. That's an interesting way to get a connection. But reacting and commenting, of course, is not enough. You should start to present and to create your own content. And the easiest way to do that is not to really create absolutely new content, but to create content. What is creating content? Creating is, you know, the curator in a museum is the one who is collecting the exhibition and presenting the exhibition. So he's not the one, the art guy, the one who develops new things, but he is the one who is creating the exhibition, who is curating the exhibition. And you could do that the same in showing contents from others on your LinkedIn profile, on your company profile, and even in groups. You could do this from content from LinkedIn, from other groups, or you can do this with content you already have, for example, on your postal operator's website. So if you have a blog, if you have a website, if you have a good new study, if you have a good white paper, if you have whatever content you have, you should use this content and really share it on LinkedIn so that other people can see this content and can benefit from this content. But you shouldn't only share it. Sharing is easy, it's just a click, but you should always have a comment on that yourself. So for example, a very good way to curating content is using hashtags, and as well, a very good tip for you is using content in another language. So for example, if you live in Hungary, let's say, or Romania, or Russia, or New Zealand, doesn't matter. Let's say Japan, doesn't really matter where you live. And you are a good speaker of English. What you could do is take an English article from somewhere, which is about, for example, direct marketing. You read it and you comment on that one. You even do a summary, like a 3-sentence, 5-sentence, what are the key learnings out of this article? And then you share this article in your country. It's coming from another country, it's speaking in a different, it's written in a different language, but you share it on your network together with your summary in your country's language. And what is happening? Everybody, first of all, sees that you are an international person. Secondly, they see that you are interested in this topic and that you are an expert in this topic because you found this topic for them. And then you even did something good because you did a summary of that content and they will love you for giving you that summary. So that's a great way to creating content. Beside of that, not only commenting and creating, but of course you should create your own content as well. You can do text, you can do photos, you can do video. These are the ones who are quite often used, but there are better things. You can use links like creating, yes. You can do articles, which are longer text. And then you can even do documents. You can put PDFs, for example. You can put Word files, you can put PowerPoints on LinkedIn and show them in your stream to everybody. So if you have a great PDF white paper, if you have a good presentation, you can put it on LinkedIn and everybody can see it there and can read it there. So it's a great way to share your content you already have or even develop some new content. And, oh, sorry, this is in German. We'll change that. I forgot to change that sentence. What you should always do if you have your own content and if you share it on LinkedIn, you should use the first hour after you presented that content to get some people to react on that content. Within the first hour, you should get some comments, you should get some reactions, some likes by other people. You can even mail them and your friends and tell them, please connect, please comment, please react on that content. And if you do this in the first hour, the LinkedIn algorithm will use that and show this content to much, much more people. I did a test last week with a group. I did a masterclass on LinkedIn and I showed that normally content, which I don't push, gets about 500 views from other people without doing anything. And then what we did, we were about 15 people in that masterclass. I put some content live in this masterclass, and 8 of these people in the masterclass were commenting directly in the first 15 minutes on this content. And I got not 5 from it, but now more than 1500 views on that same content. So with these some comments, I got a triple in exposure for that content. So that is, use the golden hour after publishing your content to show it. And then if you have the right strategy, the right profile, and you started to present some content, then you start to network with other members. You want to have a big network on LinkedIn. You want to have more direct contacts. Why? Because you can only message direct contacts. You want to have a lot of second and third degree contacts, because these are the ones who will be shown to you in searches. You want as well to have a lot of second and third degree contacts, because these are the ones who can find you in their searches. And then, of course, more contacts give you a better status on LinkedIn, give you higher trust in LinkedIn. And in the end, you get a greater range, you get a greater exposure to your network. But to make that clear, it's always quality versus quantity. You don't and shouldn't accept everybody. You should try to get your network according to your strategy. So, and that's important, and that's the difference. In the past, you sometimes connected with somebody. A lot of times you would probably got connection requests from others and you said yes or no, but you didn't build your network on a strategic way. And that's something you really should do different. You should think, who are the contacts I want to have? And after you optimize your profile and you put on some content, you really should go active to that contact you would like to have. So let's say you are working in the sales of one of your postal operators and you want to have more letter shops in there, or you are working for an industry sector like, let's say, pharmacies, and you want to have pharmacies in there or whatsoever. You should really go into that industry and really look for these contacts and then directly contact them and ask them to be in your network. And of course, you have to offer them some trust. So you should optimize your profile for them so that they think, okay, that's an interesting guy, that's an interesting woman. I have to connect with them because they have interesting content, they have an interesting CV. I would like to be connected to them. And then you really start to build your quality network. And one very special tip from me, it's very easy to just send out an unpersonalized anonymous message. So if you click on just connect, you normally will be directly connected. What you should always do is to personalize this first message to the person you would like to connect to, and you should tell them why you would like to connect with them. So let's go on. You communicate with them. There are a lot of ideas you can do that, birthday and commenting and messages and company news. You can ask questions. Well, you all know that. And in the end, you start to capitalize your network. So what you're doing is you are looking for target group capitalization, meaning, for example, you're doing a webinar. You can capitalize your network in showing them that you are doing this webinar and inviting them to that webinar. And of course, you can use individual targets to have B2B selling. And what you should always remind is that you will do your business not on LinkedIn, but you will do that off LinkedIn. You are using LinkedIn to prepare your business, and then you go offline or online, but not on LinkedIn, and you will make your sale. But LinkedIn is the base for this connection, for your communication, for your relationship. You should have some controlling, some key KPIs. So what I would recommend for you, go on this link. So vita.com, go LinkedIn SSI, and LinkedIn is calculating your personal social selling index every night and have a look. The maximum is 100. Really good is everything about 75 and more. And you probably have a little bit less at the moment. So you should have a look what your LinkedIn SSI is and try to get it better. And last but not least, this is not done in a day. So everything about LinkedIn is about continuity. So you should really do your work, sometimes daily, sometimes only weekly or quarterly, but you should really do this on a day-to-day work. This was your personal perspective, and the company perspective is nearly the same, but of course there's something add-on. So if you're looking this from your postal operator's perspective, first of all, you should evaluate the potential for LinkedIn in your country and in your target groups. In Germany, for example, there are about 15 million people on LinkedIn already. So about half of nearly a half of everybody who's working is on LinkedIn. So the potential is really huge. There are nearly every company is on LinkedIn in nearly every industry sector. The bigger the company, the more likely it's on LinkedIn. This might be a little bit different in your country. So have a look which companies are on LinkedIn, which people in these companies are on LinkedIn, and how big is the potential there is. But believe me, the potential with 722 million people on LinkedIn is huge. Then define your strategy as a company. Afterwards, build up your company profile. So you don't have only a personal profile, there are company profiles as well. And nearly the same I talked about in the personal profile is going for the company profile. And then this is very important. You have to give your employees training, because the company profile is not really that important on LinkedIn. The company is made of people. It's made of the employees of this company. And LinkedIn is wanting to connect people with people. So the most important part is to give the employees training how to optimize their LinkedIn profiles for the company, and even to start to have corporate influencers on LinkedIn. That might be your CEO, but it might be salespeople, it might be even technical people, and really have these people on LinkedIn to go there, to out there, and to post content. And then you have to help everybody with creating great content. And that's the company perspective on that. It's not that different from the strategy you have on a personal level, but it's connecting your company strategy with your personal strategy. And if you are doing this on a very daily and continuous level, you're not anymore locked out. And even in a lockdown, like a lot of countries have at the moment, you can have connections, you can have relationships to a lot of people, and you can make a lot of sales. And especially as the next months in a lot of countries will not be very easy, at least in Europe and the Americas, it's a great time to be on LinkedIn, and it's a great time to optimize your profile and your work there and really start using that and building up your personal network and your company's network on LinkedIn. So I hope you got some good ideas, and I'm open to questions from everybody. Thanks a lot for this, first of all. And I hope there are some questions now. So I'm now both moderator and speaker. So thanks, Robert, for that nice words. So I'm happy about that, but I would be happy as well. The link for the SSI, we will do this, Ronnie. Yes, I will do that. We will. I can even do it now. Give me a second. I put that link in the comments. Give me 1 second. Working. Yep. I will put that one here. So you saw the link. The link is now in the links. So recommendation, do you give and receive from the same persons? Is that not strange? Gary, yes and no. That's a very good question. It's quite often that you do something like, if you give me one, I give you one as well, recommendation. And of course, this is a little bit strange. On the other side, if you give a recommendation to somebody and you are on the same, well, if it's a not asynchronous, but well, if it's a connection on the same level, for example, you work together in a project, it would be quite normal that you would give your recommendations to each other because you know each other on the same level. It would be different now if one of you would give me a recommendation on LinkedIn for my LinkedIn knowledge. Of course, you could give me one. Well, I hope so. And on the other side, I couldn't give you one because I don't know you, Gregory. So that would be a little bit ridiculous and strange. But normally it's okay, at least if you work on the same level or if you work with each other in a project or together in a company. Jan Kerr is asking about the open to work tech that some people in their profile photo. That's something LinkedIn developed over the last, I think it's about 6 months old. So they invented it with COVID-19 and the problems in a lot of countries. So for the ones who haven't seen it, it's in the profile photo. There's some written in there, open to work. I think there are two sides to this coin. On one side, it makes very clear that you are open to work, meaning you are looking for a job. And if you don't have a job at the moment, it might be a good way to show that you are open to work. On the other side, if you have a profile which has this open to work, but then it's not a good profile, there's no UP, no USP from you in there. It's not a good profile. You don't have a good picture in there. You don't have a good info about yourself in there. Then this is not a good way to do it. So it's a little bit, you have to have a great profile. And if you are really looking for a job hard, it might be a good way, but there might be better ways. Like, for example, don't have this open to work in your profile picture, but target the people who might give you work and get in connection with them and to really have a dialogue with them. So that might be the better way. So next question from Olivier, the complementary between LinkedIn and direct mail campaign. Would you advise direct marketing manager and post to use LinkedIn coupled with direct mail? Yes, I would advise so, but not on a huge level. So if we are thinking about direct mail, like 100,000 mail pieces, then the answer is not really. But to connect this on a smaller level, it's a great way. With everybody you have connected who has this mail address, not email, but normal mail, postal mail address on LinkedIn, he will show it to you. And that's something which is really great because you can then, for example, send him a postal mail. And I did this several times now. I connected with somebody on LinkedIn. I sent him a postal mail afterwards with a book or something else. And I got really, really great connections out of that. So it's a little bit more, let's say, smaller campaigns. But these small campaigns might give you a really, really great feedback. Then we have a tip from Robert in Office 364, your corporate Outlook. Yes, you can do that. You can integrate a LinkedIn, not only I think with Office 365 and Outlook, you can do it as well, I think, with your Gmail account. But from a data security and data protection point of view, this has two sides because LinkedIn is getting your contacts as well. So think about it, whether you would like to do it or not. It's a good way, it's an easy way, but sometimes it might be not perfect. So think about that one if you want to do it from a data protection point of view as well. So we are coming to an end. I would like to do the following. I would stay on for some minutes, and if there are anybody who wants to discuss or has a question, I will answer them. But first of all, I would like to say thank you to everybody. I hope you had a fun session in the morning. You had a good hour. And I would like to invite you already on behalf of the UPU Direct Marketing Advisory Board to our next innovation session. That one will be, the next innovation talk will be on Wednesday, the 27th of January. We will send around the date in the next days, and you will can be sure that we will have a very, very interesting, innovative topic again. So we had artificial intelligence, we had social sellings. Stay tuned what our next topic might be, but already put in your calendar the 27th of January. Again, the same times, 9 in the morning and 6 in the evening in European time. And I wish all of you a great Christmas time, a happy new year, and please stay healthy wherever you are and have a good time. And if you have questions, I will stay on and answer every question there might be. Thanks a lot to everybody and have a good day. Bye-bye.